Thanks. Thank you very much, Ron, and thank you everyone for coming out this morning. I'm sure you have a lot of more important things to do. It's really nice, though, that you take an interest in your healthcare. I'm going to see if I can go back to that last slide. These numbers are, like Ron said, they're data that are obtained by the federal government. So this isn't something that we make up. And when you consider having a joint replacement, it is a major life decision. So, I mean, these numbers don't lie. And you should really do your homework when you're a patient, especially in this day and age. And just, I ask you to do your homework and make your own decision, but these numbers don't lie. And the reason for these numbers is not just the doctors. This is a team approach. Our nursing care and our rehab specialists, our physical therapists are really, I think, some of the best in the country. And it's more of a personal, it's a more personal approach. When you have your joint replaced at our place, you're gonna have a nurse that takes care of maybe one or just two patients that day. They're not running around taking care of eight patients at a time. And I really think that makes a big, big difference in your outcome. So this morning, I'm gonna talk first. I didn't wanna have to follow Dr. Mead because he's a superstar. And no one can look good following him. So I'm actually gonna talk about trying to avoid a knee replacement. And I'm gonna talk about some minor office procedures that we're doing and some minor outpatient surgical procedures, minimally invasive techniques to try and restore or regenerate your cartilage before we jump to a knee replacement. A little bit about my background. Ron, you're wrong. I actually was the Lehigh doctor for over a decade. And I treated a lot of high-level athletes with very serious cartilage injuries. And that kind of spurred my passion for articular cartilage defects and treating cartilage defects in these athletes and trying to get their cartilage to heal, to get them back on the field as quickly and safely as possible. As I've gotten older, my practice has aged with me, and I now treat a lot of arthritis patients. So I've taken these techniques and tried to extrapolate them to my older patients, again, to try and stimulate or regenerate cartilage formation in an effort to avoid a knee replacement. As most of you know, knee replacements have become a very popular surgery in America. How many people in here have had their knee replaced? Anyone? Yeah. So an estimated 4.7 million Americans have undergone this procedure. 3 million women, 1.7 million men. And with the baby boomer population, this number is exploding. Every year it's going up exponentially. So this is a kind of a typical total knee replacement incision. So anyone that tells you it doesn't hurt at all and it's a minimally invasive procedure, it's kind of hard to argue with this. This is an x-ray, a side view of a knee replacement. Knee replacement, I like to think of it as retreading a tire. We're not replacing the entire knee from here to here. We're making very fine cuts on the end of the thigh bone and very fine cuts on the shin bone, and we're putting a metal implant on both sides. We're basically essentially putting in a new hinge. But again, it is a rather invasive procedure, and it's something that we don't take lightly. So in my eyes, it's always a last result. And for those of you who have seen me, you know that I don't take it lightly. So I'm going to talk a little bit about alternatives. Some really interesting things going on right now in this country to try and avoid that final step of a knee replacement. So this is a schematic. I'm sure most of you know about the knee, but it's basically a hinge joint. You have your femur or thigh bone, your tibia or your shin bone, and your kneecap or patella. Covering the thigh bone is what's called the articular cartilage, like the gristle on the end of a chicken bone. There's a cartilage surface on the end of the femur, and there's a cartilage surface on the tibia, and then there's a cartilage surface on the undersurface of your kneecap. So this is a typical patient with an arthritic knee with an area of cartilage damage. I like to tell my patients that your knee is like a tire. You're born with so many treads, and over time those treads can wear, whether it's from an acute injury or it's just a chronic eventual breakdown of that cartilage. So I'm going to talk about some techniques, and all the operative techniques that I mentioned in the following slides are done arthroscopically. So instead of that big total knee incision, you're going to have just two little poke holes. And we're attempting to try and get that cartilage to regenerate or to heal over through three tiny little poke holes, okay? The oldest cartilage-saving technique is what's called microfracture. Microfracture has actually been around since probably, Tom, the early 80s? Mm-hmm. Yeah. It was developed by a gentleman named Dr. Stedman, very famous guy in Colorado. Again, it's an arthroscopic technique. Two or three little poke holes. It takes literally about 15 minutes. And it's for a patient with a full-thickness cartilage defect. So this is that nice, smooth cartilage surface. Almost looks like a cue ball. But this patient has a large lesion on the inner part of their knee, on the end of the thigh bone here. You can see this is, we call this bare bone. The bone's exposed. So this is a knee that a lot of people are replacing. In the microfracture technique, we do it arthroscopically, and we drill several little holes in the bone here, okay? And these, we are drilling directly into the bone. It sounds painful, but it's really not. These patients have minimal pain. But what will happen is you'll get bleeding from each of these tiny microfractures, and you'll develop what's called a super clot. And that super clot eventually evolves into what we call fibrocartilage or fibrous cartilage. I like to call it scar cartilage. It's not quite as good as the hyaline cartilage that you're born with, but the goal is to get a scar there that doesn't hurt. About 100,000 microfractures are performed each year in this country. If you read Stedman's results, he states that he has up to 80% really good results in patients under the age of 45. It is somewhat of a commitment, although it's minimally invasive. You have to be off your feet for 6 weeks to let that cartilage surface heal over. I personally have done a lot of these, and in the right patient, it works. Autologous chondrocyte implantation, or ACI as we refer to it, is an outpatient surgical procedure. It's done through several small poke hole or arthroscopy portals. It is two surgeries, so it is more of a commitment. But this procedure is an attempt to regenerate your native hyaline cartilage. It's not fibrous cartilage. It's going to be that hyaline cartilage you're born with. It's again aimed at younger patients, 40s, even 50s, I've done them in. The first operation, we go in arthroscopically and we just harvest some cartilage cells. These cells are literally sent to a lab where they're multiplied on a petri dish over a 5-week course. And then the second surgery, we go in and implant the cartilage cells. So this is kind of a schematic. This is a patient with a full thickness defect like that first patient you saw. You can get up to a centimeter, 2 centimeter defect. We go in and we biopsy the cartilage up in this area. This is deemed a non-weight bearing area. People will tell you don't really need that cartilage because it's non-weight bearing. Cells are harvested, they're sent to the lab, multiplied, and then we go back in through a small incision and implant them in the defect, and we cover it with a small flap of what we call periosteum, which is the lining of the bone. ACI has actually been around quite a while. I would say that it's becoming a little less popular than it had been because there are some other techniques, but it's still something that we like to use in our toolbox. Next technique I've done a lot of, it's called mosaicplasty. It, as opposed to the first two techniques, which a patient only has cartilage breakdown, this is used in patients that have both cartilage and bone loss, okay? I like to call it the hair plug procedure. We're literally taking cylindrical plugs of bone and cartilage from a non-weight-bearing area in the knee, and we're transferring it into the defect. Again, it's done arthroscopically. This is a nice schematic. This is a patient. You can do this for probably up to a 2-centimeter defect. The plugs are harvested again along that non-weight-bearing area in the knee, and they are in the same surgery transferred into the lesion. So we're trying to get that bone and cartilage surface to heal over. Very successful procedure if it's done in the right patient. These procedures, you got to do them in the right patients. You have to have intact ligaments, you have to have normal alignment, and it has to be a small isolated defect in the cartilage. If someone comes in and they're missing cartilage all throughout the knee, this is not going to be an option for them. This is a really interesting technique that I've done quite a bit in the last 2 years. It's called an osteochondral allograft transplantation. Allograft means that we are using bone and cartilage from a cadaver, okay? It's a fresh cadaver. It has to be, it's in a person that's died less than 30 days ago. Basically, we see a patient in the office, they have this huge defect in their bone and cartilage, up to 5 centimeters. I'm gonna show you a picture of a kid I did that's 19 years old. He had a five centimeter defect. We get a CAT scan of your knee, we size it exactly, and we find, the company finds a cadaver with the exact same dimensions as your knee. And then we harvest in the OR from we literally get an entire thigh bone comes in, and we harvest it using a machine that's very precise. So we're attempting to restore the normal anatomy. This is actually that young kid, and you can see his growth plate is right here. He's only 19 years old. But so this is an MRI. This is the end of the thigh bone here, okay? And you can see his cartilage surface on this side is beautiful, which you would expect in a 19-year-old. See that black line there? That's the articular cartilage. You can see on this side, he had a congenital defect called osteochondritis desiccans, which this is a large piece of bone and cartilage, which is completely breaking off here, okay? So this is an intraoperative picture of his knee. This is the thigh, but the end of the thigh bone. This is normal articular cartilage right here. You can see the defect. This was about 5 centimeters by 2.5 centimeters. This is when we were finished. Look at how beautiful that fit. When we're done, you can barely tell that he had a surgical procedure. This kid is, I actually did both of his knees. He's back to playing soccer at a year. I'm gonna change gears a little bit and talk about what we call biologics. Those who follow sports and hear all the time about star athletes, you know, Steph Curry, Travis Arnold, Dez Bryant. They get injured, you hear about them having stem cells or PRP injections for either a ligament injury or a ligament tear, and it's generating a healing response that's getting them back quicker return from their injury, okay? We are extrapolating these techniques now for arthritic knees. So these are two minimally invasive procedures that are performed right in the office. They're literally an injection, okay? PRP stands for platelet-enriched plasma, and all of you have probably heard the term stem cell therapy, okay? These are two procedures performed in the office using your own cells to try and restore or regenerate the cartilage surface. Again, it's performed in the office. I'm gonna talk a little bit about platelet-enriched plasma, okay? You come in, Kim Sharon draws your blood. There's Kim over there, everybody wave to Kim. Kim draws your blood. Your blood has different types of cells, right? Red cells carry oxygen, white cells fight infection, and platelets, okay? Platelets are those cells in your blood that are the first to arrive at an injury. When I cut myself shaving this morning, it clotted off because your platelets travel to that site and they help clot, but they also help heal. So if the theory is that if we dry your blood and we spin it down and isolate these platelets and then inject them around injured tissue, whether it's a ligament injury or a tendon injury or an arthritic defect, that it will stimulate your body to heal that damaged surface. So PRP has been shown to have really good clinical results for tendon and ligament regeneration, allowing quicker return to sports. There's not too many people in here, I don't think, that are looking to return to sports quicker, but they want to have less pain, okay? So we've been using it for the treatment of early arthritic knees. You know, if you come in to see me and your x-ray shows full-blown bone-on-bone arthritis, this is not going to work for you. But if there's some early to moderate arthritis and you've failed maybe cortisone or you've been taking Motrin forever and you're not happy, there are a lot of studies now that are showing this can be effective, very effective for early arthritis. Has anyone in here had the rooster comb injections? Okay, so you're all familiar with that. There are a lot of studies that are showing that these are more effective than the rooster comb injections. And it's a blood draw and an injection. Okay. Everyone wants to talk about stem cells. Stem cells, stem cells, stem cells. What is a stem cell? Stem cell, I like to call stem, they're like baby cells. They're embryonic cells in your body. You have them that have not, they have the potential to develop into any other type of cell. They can develop into a cartilage cell. They can develop into a bone cell. So they're commonly now being used for the treatment of ligament and tendon injuries, kind of like PRP. It's performed in the office. It is a little more invasive than the PRP. It's not a blood draw. We have to we draw the stem cells from your body fat. I use a bone marrow aspirate of the hip. We pull it out of the back of your pelvic bone here. We pull a bone marrow, what's called a bone marrow aspirate. And again, that's spun down in the office in a centrifuge. The stem cells are isolated and then they're injected into your knee. Although we're using it in other places. We're using it for rotator cuff tears now. We're using it for ligament injuries, kind of like PRP, but little different approach because this not only has platelets, it also has stem cells, which again, can develop into all different types of cells. Ideally, they develop into cartilage cells. The results, it's so early in the process, there's not a lot in the literature, but I think the concept is excellent. So in summary, you gotta stay educated as a patient, be an informed consumer, do your research. A knee replacement is a life commit, it's a big commitment. Anyone that's had one in here knows it's a big deal. You should talk to your surgeon about non-surgical options. You want a surgeon that, you know, has a large armamentarium in their toolbox, okay? And you want to ask them always about minimally invasive techniques. My girls. So, Tom's going to come up and talk a little bit.